गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. नाउ दिस इज द लेक्चर फॉर वाइकेरियस लायबिलिटी एंड वी विल बी टेकिंग अप लेक्चर टू ऑफ वाइकेरियस लायबिलिटी ऑन वाइकेरियस लायबिलिटी. नाउ व्हेन वी टिल नाउ सो फार वी हैव डिस्कस्ड दैट व्हेन अ पर्सन कमिट्स अ रॉन्ग दैट पर्सन इज मेड लायबल फॉर द रॉन्गफुल एक्शन इन एज अ जनरल रूल एंड द एक्शन ऑफ दैट पर्सन डज नॉट इनकर एनी लायबिलिटी ऑन एनी अदर पर्सन. But there are certain cases where the liability of one person for the act that is done by another person may arise, and such a situation in which the liability arises is known as vicarious liability. The word vicarious liability is the word that I have always stated that it's a latent term, right? And in tort, when we talk about in tort, a person is there are three essentials that we discussed previously that are taken into consideration to fulfill this aspect. That is, first one was tortious act by one person. There is some relationship that exists between the wrongdoer and one who is being made liable, and there is certain connection with the tortious act and the relation they have, right? There is some wrong that has been done by the another party, and there is some connection between the act. Then we have also discussed maxims like U facet for elim facet per se, again, which is a latent term, and which means that he who acts through another does the act himself. This is the maxim that we did in the last class itself. Then we also focused on principle of respondent superior. Right now, when we talk about these principles that were there, the maxim that we discussed, according to the maxim that is there, that Q facet for elim facet per se, if the nature of things, the master is obliged to perform, there are certain things that master is obliged to perform, the duties by the employing servant, then the employer will be liable to any act, will be responsible for the act of the employee in the same way. That in which, like if the work act has been done by the employer, right? There is, it is indirectly making the principal liable for the act, and therefore we are seeing that it amounts to strict liability provisions. It's it's one of the non-fault liability. We also looked into the aspect of respondent superior that says that the superior will be held liable for any act which is there. Then we looked into deep pocket theory that. The person who is in the better position, financial better position, will be held liable. We have then focused on the aspect of principal and agent, okay, and wherein we have discussed. So when we discussed about principal and agent relationship, we have discussed that there is a joint and several liability of the principal and agent. Right, and we have also looked into the case. So this is what we did in our lecture one. Now in lecture two, we'll be talking about the liability of partners, and we'll be talking about liability of master. And this lecture, then to start with the vicarious liability of partners. When we talk about this, we say that it is the Indian Partnership Act that lays down that the relationship between partners is that of principal and agent. Okay, so the rule of the law of agency will be applicable in the cases in order to define their liability. Thus, when we talk about any firm, all partners will be liable to the same extent as principal is liable for the act of his or her agent. And for tort committed by any partner in ordinary course of business of the firm, then all the partners will be held liable to the same extent as guilty partner is. So we need to look into this aspect that when you're talking about the vicarious liability of partners, they're working within their they're working as a partner of the firm, and they are carrying out the purpose of that business. So this is one of the important essentials that should be taken into consideration while taking the vicarious liability of partners aspect. Because here, when we talk about this, we say that they are into the ordinary course of business of the firm. That is, they are carrying out the end result of that business that they are taking care of together, right? And only under such circumstances, all the partners will be liable to the same extent as the partner who has committed the offense. So the even when we talk about the liability of the partners, we say that it is joint and several, right? They'll be joint and severally liable for towards the any act which has been done. So same principles will be applicable when we talk about this aspect. That why, because the what maxim will be applicable on this, it is same, that is qui facit per alien facit per se. So this is based on this legal latent term, or you can say maxim, that we describes the liability of various partners in a firm. So here we need to, we'll take up one case, which is Hamley versus Houston and Company. Now this is a case where one of the partner of the defendant firm, acting within the general scope of his authority as a partner, bribed the plaintiff's clerk and induced him to make a breach of contract with his employer. What happened, that the person bribed and took out some confidential information. This is what was done by the defendant's firm, right? Which where there were two partners, and one of the partner bribed the clerk of another firm in order to take out some confidential information, right? So that was relating to the plaintiff's business. So it was held that both the partners of the firm are liable for the wrongful act. The act was inducing breach of contract that was committed by one of them, but both were held liable for the act that was committed by one. So when we talk about partnership, we say that whatever the losses and damages that are being suffered by the plaintiff will be shared by both the partners. They'll be liable to pay either out of their own favor. When we talk about partnership, we need to look into the type of partnership also. Well, we'll not get into the concept of type of partnership, but as a general rule, when we talk about partnership, partners who are active partners in a partnership firm will be held liable for the damages. They will be made liable to recover, to make good the losses and damages that are caused to the plaintiff because of the act of one partner, one person, one partner. Another aspect that we'll be talking about is vicarious liability of master. Now, here, when we talk about vicarious liability of master, the statement that was made by Lord Chelmsford, it has long been established by law that a master is liable to third persons for any injury or damage done through the negligence or unskillfulness of a servant acting in his master's employ. The reason of this is that every act which is done by servant in the course of his duty is regarded as done by his master, right? Done by the master's order, and consequently, it is the same as if it were master's own act. So when we are talking about this aspect, what are we referring to? We are saying that if a servant does a wrongful act, right, in the course of employment, the master will be liable. Now, there are certain essential aspects that we will look into later in the lecture to decide that whether the master will be liable or not. So the servant, of course, will be liable, but master will be held liable. The degree to which the master will be held liable will be more than as the servant will be held liable. And the wrongful act of the servant is deemed to be the act of master. That's why master is held liable. And this doctrine of liability of master for act of the servant is based on the maxim respondent superior, which means that we have already done in the last class also, which means let the principal be liable, and it puts the master in the same position as he had done the act himself. And it also derives validity from the maxim, that is qui facit per alien facit per se, which we already discussed, which means he who does an act through another is deemed in law to be done by himself. So since for the wrong done by servant, the master can also be held liable for vicariously, plaintiff has a choice. This was already, I've made you note of this, that plaintiff will have a choice to bring an action against either or both of them. Their liability will be joint and several, as they are considered to be joint tortfeasor. These are certain aspects that were already discussed. And the reason for maxim that is there, that respondent superior, is basically been adopted because master is seen to be in the better position to entertain the claim, and because he has his large pocket and also ability to pass on the burden, therefore master is held liable. So these are deep pocket theory, respondent superior maxim, that is qui facit per alien facit per se, will touch, be taken into consideration while deciding the liability. So liability arises even though the servant has acted under the instructions and for of the master. So we need to decide, there are various factors that we need to take into consideration in order to decide whether there is actually being, can master be held liable for all the acts or not, or there are certain criteria that should be taken into consideration by the court before deciding whether the master should be held liable. Now, there are these basic ingredients that are there. First is that we need to look into, that should be satisfied. So, and that are required, right, for deciding the liability. First is the person an employee, whether there is a contract or service, or contract for service, or is it a part-time? Was it the course of employment? What is the course of employment? Whether there was any consent of the tortious act, whether the consent was implied or expressed. So we'll look into all these aspects, but today we will cover the first aspect, that is the contract for service, whether it is a contract for service or for service. Right? So the question is, now what we are doing, we are determining the liability of a person for the act of his or her servant. Right? Because in that later comes within the meaning of the word servant. A servant, we need to discuss that who servant is. When we say that, whether a person is employed or not, whether there is a contract of service, whether there is contract for service, is it part-time service that a person is doing. So servant, the word servant that we do need, we have, it means a person who is employed by his master to do some kind of work under his or her direction, control, supervision. And a servant should not be confused with the aspect of independent contractor. And therefore, here is where we need to understand these aspects, that what is contract of service, what is contract for service, who will be servant and employee, who will be independent contractor. Because when we talk about contract or service, we are talking about the master servant relationship. When we are talking about contract for service, we are talking about a contract with an independent person. Now, what distinguishes an independent contractor is that he undertakes any kind of work, and how that work is to be done is something that depends on him. He is not under the direction of anybody else. So that's why it's contract for service, where the independent contractor is designated with the work, but how that work should be executed is left on to that person, right? Like, he's not under the control of the person who is giving that him or her any contract. Like, for instance, if we say, when you travel in your car, which is being driven by your driver, right, who seems to be your employee, and if that person is driving negligently and therefore met with an accident, you will be held liable. But let's say if you're going in a taxi, right, and driver negligently causes an accident, you are not responsible, right? Because in the former case, there is master-servant relationship. And in the later case, what have you done? You are hiring. You are taking on hire a particular vehicle which belongs to somebody else, a person, and there is an independent contract between you and that person. So in the second one, it will be the taxi driver who will be liable. And it's a very common example that you will find in your books and wherever you will be reading it. Because when we talk about an independent contractor, what we need to take into consideration, that it is a contract for service. That is, you will undertake the work, but how to execute that work will be completely your prerogative to decide how it is to be done. So thus, we need to understand that who is an independent contractor. Okay, independent contractor includes, for example, plumber or electrician hired by a household, and they are usually responsible for their own tort. An independent contractor is one who undertakes to do certain work and regarding the manner in which the work is to be done. He is his own master and exercises his own jurisdiction. So when we talk about this, we say that as a general rule, the master is liable for the tort committed by his servant, but an employer is not liable for the tort committed by an independent contractor that who is employed by him or her. Right? So in when we talk about this, here we will see that this is one of the case which is there. Morgan versus Incorporated Central Council, where the plaintiff, while he was on a lawful visit to dependent premises, fell down from an open lift shaft and got injured. Now, the defendant had entrusted the job of keeping the lift safe and in proper order to certain independent contractor. It was held that for this act of negligence on the part of the independent contractor in not keeping the lift in safe condition, the defendant could not be made liable. So we need to understand the nature that exists. But is it all the situation? Is it, will it be under all the situation that the person who has entrusted a person with the duty will not be liable? No. There are some exceptions to this rule also. There are exceptions where it has been stated, where it says that where the under the independent contract, where you have hired an independent contractor, the person who is hired will be liable. So rule that a person is not liable to the independent contractor under these following conditions will be liable. Where the employer of an independent contractor authorizes the doing of an illegal act or ratifies it, the person will be liable. An employer of an independent contractor is liable in case of strict liability. An employer of an independent contractor is also liable for the danger caused on or near a highway. An employer of an independent contractor is liable for nuisance. If the wrong of the independent contractor results from master's common law duty to his servant, then the person will be liable. So these are certain exceptions to this general rule that under the contract for service, there is no master-servant relationship. And we will see this thing into consideration that there is a change in this aspect of master-servant that will come to in the ahead of in the lecture. So now we'll look into the aspect as to who is a servant. So a servant is a person, as already stated, employed by another to do the work under direction, control, supervision of another person, right? So to say, a servant is an agent who is subject to the control and supervision of his employer regarding the manner in which the work is to be done. But keep this in mind, this aspect that the manner in which it is to be done doesn't apply under certain situation that I will come now in few minutes, I'll come to that aspect also. So keep this in mind. So contract of service, when we talk about contract of service, what are the basic things, key indicators that we need to take into consideration to decide this relationship? One is master's power of selection of his servant, payment of wages or other remunerations, master right to control the method of doing the work, master's right of suspending or dismissing. Now, these are the certain indicators that are there, but it doesn't say that all the indicators should be present. Any of the indicators that are there will determine whether there exists the relationship of that of master and servant. So keep these indicators in mind, right, to understand that under what circumstances, under what situation a person will be servant or not. So like, for example, I've already given you, right, personal driver and taxi driver example that has already been given to you. So the next question is that first is whether there is contract of service. So contract of service will be defined by these four key indicators. If there is a, whether there is a contract of service or not. Clear? Now second essential was, the next question was, is whether the work that is, which work was done within the scope of employment so as to make the employer liable vicariously. Right? Because as all act done as an employee or servant or agent will not fall within the scope of vicarious liability. This I'll explain you when we'll talk about people who are working in hospitals, who are working in organizations. They are hired. Their suspension is also in the hand of the person who employed them. But still, under certain circumstances, all the situation, the aspect of vicarious liability will be applicable. For this, we have to discuss that what do we understand by course of employment, right? And here, in order to decide whether there is course of employment or not, there is this control test that was taken up by the courts. But the modern view, the control test is been taken up as not exclusive. So this was the test that was taken up, but now in addition to this control test, there are many other tests that have been taken up by the courts in order to decide whether there is a master-servant relationship or not. whether there is contract or service or not, whether if the work is done in the course of employment or not. So let's come to this test first, that is control test, that decides whether there is contract or service or for service. So the courts look at who has control over the way that the work is carried out. So control test says that supervision direction is there. If the employer sets out how the work is to be done and when it is to be done, the courts are more likely to consider the person carrying out the work to be an employee. The person who is carrying out that work is employed. So control test, in which was the test that was taken up, which is now is not an exclusive test. It is something which is being taken up by the courts. In addition to this test, there are many other tests that are taken into consideration. So control test says that you have the control over the execution of the work, right? So if on the other hand, it was up to the person carrying out, this is what already said, that who is an independent contractor, right? That we talk about the independent contractor, which is been taken up already by where there is no control test applicable. And therefore, since it will not be applicable, there is no master-servant relationship. So that's in terms of vicarious liability, it is essential to establish exactly who is classified as employees. And this may appear straightforward at first instance if it is proven that there is control over the work of the employee by the employer. But there are several other tests, as I've already stated, to determine the status of a person who is employed in an employment. Like for instance, in this case, Chemical Works Limited versus the State of Saurashtra, Supreme Court laid down that the existence of the right in the master to supervise and control the execution of work done by the servant is prima facie test. Okay, control test will be the prima facie test. That the nature of control may vary from business to business is by its nature incapable of any precise definition. Right, that it is not necessary that the employee should be proved to have exercised control over the work of the employees, that the test of control test is not of universal application, and that there are many contracts in which the master could not control the manner in which the work was done. Basically, court is saying that yes, we say that control test is there. Control test was one of the factors to decide whether master and servant relationship exists or not. But now, apart from control test, there are other tests also that we need to take into consideration to decide whether there is employment or not. Okay? Because this is a big factor to decide who will be liable in case of any kind of negligence which has been done. Right? So, and we are making a party liable for an act that has not been committed. So it's very important to understand this relationship. Another case, which is there, is Cassidy versus Ministry of Health, where the judges pointed out that this test is not universally correct. There are contract of services where the master cannot control the manner in which the work is to be done, as in the case of surgeons. Hence, so we say that the court do not use a single test, but instead have looked into various factors and circumstances before reaching out to this aspect of master and servant relationship to decide whether there is any employment or not, whether there is any the contract of employment or not between the parties. So what are these tests? First is integration test, hire and fire test, economic reality test. So we'll see what is integration test. Integration test is, and you can relate these tests with these conditions, if you remember. Okay, so these are the things that are to be taken into consideration, and it is not essential that all of them should be present. Any condition present will mark the line for that master and servant relationship, and will be taken into consideration while deciding the liability. So first one is integration test. Now, this test asks whether the person works is an integral part of the business. First thing, whether am I the important part of that business? Am I integral part? A person employed to work on the cash register in a shop would usually be an employee. However, if the machine was broken, the person called in to fix it would be probably an independent contractor. Okay, so am I the integral part of the association or not is the first thing. as his or work would not be incidental to the business running the shop. The organizational integration test has also been used, particularly for professional people where there is no right of control over the method of performance, like ours, right? There is an employer-employee relationship, but there is no control over us as to how we have to deliver our lectures. Yeah. So it is based upon the concept that an employee is an integral part, and at the same time, we are an integral part of the organization, whereas a contractor performs work for the organization but remains outside. Is it clear? And this is what was stated by the court in Cassidy versus Ministry Health case. So these are certain, this is first thing that is there, integral part. Then is the hire and fire test. Now, when we talk about this, the latest test to determine whether a worker is an employee is the hire and fire test. The person who retains the power of dismissal is usually the employer for the purpose of vicarious liability. So when we talk about this modern trend, these modern authorities have applied this hire and fire test, right? Where a person who employs another person and that other person is the paymaster, that other person has a power to fire, to discharge, to hire that first person, right? And that other person will be the master for the purpose of vicarious liability, right? If it is only the control test, if you would have taken only the control test, which was to be applied in every case, then in various cases, these professions would have been excluded, right? And even the hire and fire test would have not stood correctly. But these are certain things that are taken into consideration. And it has been stated that wherever there is control with respect to hiring and firing of a person, though there is no direction that has been given, no supervision of the work is there, but still there exists a relationship, okay? And therefore, which would be essential in taking into consideration the liability of the employer for the employee. Clear? So when we are talking about this, we say that yes, professional aspects, in order to include such kind of professional employments, court have moved ahead from control test and included integral and hire and fire test. Another important test is economic reality test. Now, economic reality test is what? Here the court may also look at the contract between the two parties, and these terms may indicate the status of the relationship. It may be a contract.